Welcome to another episode of In Conversation with Industry Expert. Hope you guys are staying healthy and safe in whatever part of the world you're in. Today's topic is a very interesting one. It's called blockchain organizing. Many companies have embarked on involving blockchain in their own businesses as distributed ledger technology, and they have done POCs and they've conducted experiments. But many of them have struggled to go beyond that point. Part of it could be attributed to changes that is required around data organization. And that is the topic of today's discussion. And I would like to welcome you, Paul Bessems, who is one of the experts. Paul, welcome.
Thank you, Anirvan. Nice to see you again.
Absolutely. So, Paul, you've been in the industry for many, many years. Why don't we start with a bit of a background of how you got involved in this space?
Yeah. Well, thank you for inviting me. Maybe start before I get acquainted with blockchain. That was in 2013. But I studied industrial engineering and management science at the Technical University in Eindhoven. And immediately I was thinking about not only the technology, but also the way of organizing stuff. So what I basically do is I bring together modern organization science. So we see we have a new contact from physical to digital, and for that you need new organization models together with disruptive technologies. So if you bring those two together, you have a really strong business case. So what I do, I help organizations with their digital strategies, the development of digital ecosystems, blockchain, and digital assembly line. So that's my focus, and I do that as a speaker, as a trainer, as a consultant, but I'm also an entrepreneur, so I help startups for starting in the blockchain scene. I got acquainted with the scene in 2013 when I read the white paper, and I immediately saw not a technical solution but an organizational solution, and it was really, and for me it still is, an organizational solution for the enormous amount of digital waste, we call it, in offices. So if you work on a new organization model with blockchain technology, you could save enormous money, time, and I call it digital waste. I think we'll come to that, but around 30 to 40% of organizations' costs are asking data for other companies. So you don't have the same reality, and then you have to ask for information or clarify things. And that's a huge, so probably a good thing is to look at blockchain. How can we address the digital waste? What Einstein said, bureaucracy is the death of any achievement. I call it digital waste is the death of any achievement. So that's my focus at this moment.
Can you elaborate with some examples?
Yeah, what's important is if you look at the context, we're coming from industrial revolution and the context across materials. So producing a car or a television is totally different. But if you look at data, it's the same. It's zeros and ones. And I think it starts with understanding what data are. Data are a representation of our real world. It's an abstraction. It's an artifact. And it's imperfect, but it's a good way to deal with transactions, for instance. So I think basically it starts with understanding what data are. And they are totally different if you compare them with physical flows, for instance. So if you look at data logistics, it's much more easier than physical logistics. For instance, so basically we start with understanding what data is, and from that point, how could you organize supply and demand of data with lower friction? So you come into data economics, data science, but basically most people look at data through their keyboard or their screen, and that's it. But you have to really try to peel the onion and understand what data is and how to organize supply and demand of data. That's really important starting point. And that's also an example where we start with our projects. We start with a better understanding of what data is long before we start with solutions like blockchain, for instance.
Right. So you've described a way in which you use blockchain to essentially reorganize an organization centered around technology, around data. And you're calling it blockchain organizing, right?
Blockchain organizing. It's a combination of disruptive technology, what blockchain is, with new organizing models. That's what we call blockchain organizing.
So for the benefit of the viewers, why don't you expand upon the theory of blockchain organizing?
Well, it's not really a theory because it's two pillars, you could say. It's a disruptive technology, but you could also say, well, blockchain is not that disruptive. It's built up with long existing technologies like distributed systems, Leslie Lambert in the 70s, the hashing was already in the 70s, 80s. So it's really But it combined, it's really disruptive. And if you combine a new technology with new ways of organizing, so what I mean with new organizing is at this moment, default, we see the corporation or the company as the best way to bring production factors, land, labor, and capital together to make a product, for instance. And on the input side, we see a new kind of production factor is called data. So organizing of data is totally different than organizing land, capital, and labor. So you have to really understand that. And that's more on the organization part of blockchain organizing. And the technical part, most people know the technical part at this moment, but you really have to combine them together. Otherwise, I use those pictures very often. You have a kind of car, which is with a horse in front of it, you know? So it's really a new technology. If you put a new technology in an old body, a new soul in an old body, it doesn't work. And we've seen that, if you want some examples, we've seen that with EDI in the 80s, we had internet in the 90s, then came clouds, and now comes blockchain away. All those technology didn't improve our productivity really. So we invested a lot in that, but it's called of active emergence. We do a lot, but we don't get any further in productivity growth, for instance. So really you have to look at technology and new ways of organizing.
Why blockchain?
Well, I think if you, for instance, I was this morning at the presentation of a graduate. If you compare, for instance, EDI, a lot of people say, well, blockchain is a kind of electric data interchange, but it's really not the same in some aspects. One of the aspects is, for instance, that with EDI, you copy data in your own database and it's going to live its own life. You, Arnivan, you have only one date of birth. It should be logical, put in one in place. Physical, you could say, well, an attribute is on 5-6 places, but on the logical side, you have one address of your company, you have one chamber of commerce number, etc. So basically, you have to look at what data is and how do you store it. So don't make a copy of data, just organize access to data. So that's very important, different view on data. You don't have to own data, you need to organize access to data. And blockchain is really good in that because if I ask a question to your personal data service, so your attributes like your age or your living place, it's in your personal data service. Also your name, address, and zip code. So I mostly use that example. If you buy a book at Amazon, they don't need your name, address, zip code, and place name in their database. They just get access to your personal database and you can organize it on a blockchain because you have, for instance, 100 attributes in your personal database and they only need 4. So what the digital assembly line does is they make a token of those 4 attributes, name, address, zip code, and place name. And the only thing Amazon can do is use those 4 attributes to print the label. They can't store it in their database. So you have no redundant data. You have no waste of data. You have no bad quality of data because you have only one address. And I organize access with keys, private and public key. So blockchain is much more than only Bitcoin. It's a way of organizing data, not that you have to own your data in your CRM, HRM, or ERP system. You organize access to data. And that's also in the GDPR, the new privacy law, data minimalization. So I think in 10, 15 years, when I say I give you access to my data, it's not allowed for Amazon to own my data. That's not allowed anymore. So it's really, if you look at other ways of organizing, so change it 180 degrees, not data in the company's databases, but in my personal databases, then you combine new ways of organizing with new technologies, and that's a really strong combination.
What would you say are some of the top benefits of combining blockchain and the organization side of things, as you explained?
Well, if you look at digital waste, we estimate, not only we, but also if you look at Gartner or Accenture, McKinsey, they do all kind of research on that. They estimate that around 30% of the total organization cost is in verifying claims, asking information to other actors. So basically the last decades, the companies wanted to be more agile. So they don't do it themselves, they contract it out. I think Accenture estimated that the last 2 years, the amount of actors you have to deal with doubled. So, well, that's really lean and mean, but if you don't look at the coordination between you and your supplier, the total cost will rise, not go lower. So basically, I think one of the best business model is looking at the digital waste side. How much can I reduce my information costs? So if you look at transaction costs, one of the parts is dealing with data and information. And that's around 30% of your total costs. Basically, that's a way of reducing those costs. And I think that's a really good business model. Besides quality of data or time, etc. But if you purely look at the costs, it's around 30% of your total organization costs if you look at office organizations. So it's not physical organizations that make stuff, but more the office organizations. But office organizations is around 70% in Western countries. 70% of the people are behind the computer asking each other questions. So look at yourself. What are you doing during the day? You're emailing, you're asking questions, you're answering questions. The only reason why you ask a question to somebody else is if you don't have the same reality. If we two have the same reality, so how many employees do we have in our department? If you have 12 and I have 12, I don't have to ask you a question. But probably you have 15 in your Excel sheet and I have 10 in my Excel sheet and we don't have the same reality. That's the reason why we have to call each other or email. And you know, I know that basically one of the advantages of blockchain is that's create a shared reality. You don't have to ask questions to each other. You just organize access to a shared database. That's it.
So what you're saying is 30% of 70%, which is more than 20%, of costs can potentially be removed by implementing a solution like this.
One example. Most people know that if you look at container shipping from China to Rotterdam, I think you know the example, the port of Rotterdam, ABN AMRO. There are 28 companies between China and Rotterdam. They don't do anything on the physical side. They're just asking data, put a stamp on it, and just checking things. 28 companies that, in the long run, they are obsolete, for instance. So that's a really good example. Too many actors in supply chain at the moment.
Where does a company start its journey?
Mostly the projects we do, you know of our learning and working program, we call it the certified program. So students, they come one day per week to, you'd say, college for knowledge, and 4 days they work on projects. Most of the projects we do is you can call it exploration. They want to find out feasibility. Is blockchain something for us? Basically, we try to do it in a consortium from the start. So not one company, but more companies in a project. So basically what we do is ask the question, could blockchain improve digital waste in this situation, for instance? And mostly the answer is yes. And then you come to the question, how can we organize in a supply chain or in a digital ecosystem, how can we organize the digital assembly line? So digital assembly line is blockchain creates rich data. And if you put those data together with data logistics, you have the digital assembly line. So basically we start with feasibility. Is it possible? Is the technology ready? Is it mature enough? And the second stage is mostly we try to make a kind of a digital assembly line simulator. So we simulate how could you interact, how could servers interact with each other without any human interaction? That's what the digital assembly line is. So what the physical assembly line did in fabrics is reducing friction. And the digital assembly line is going to do the same thing, but then in offices. So that's basically what we do. We set up a kind of simulator, and more people, they got engaged, they become enthusiastic, and that's the next stage. And eventually, the end game is a digital ecosystem where we can interact with each other without any human interaction. So if you look at Bitcoin Core, the longest blockchain, they do, I think, 300,000 transactions each day. They don't have an office. They don't have employees. It's just technology that brings supply and demand together. That's it. No invoice, no purchase order, no local accounting systems. That's really the future. And you could call it decentralized autonomous organizations. So we know that we have autonomous cars, we can see them. I think more and more people can imagine decentralized autonomous organizations without any human interaction.
One of the pillars of modern day organization is performance measurements and KPIs. Mm-hmm. The example that you took, you talked about 28 different parties. Mm-hmm. How do you get them aligned and rally behind a common cause? I'm sure a project like this would definitely need something like this.
Yeah, definitely. And I think you could look at, for instance, at this moment, there's also a lot of use cases coming up, and we know all kind of IBM use cases. If you look at SAP, they have a different approach. What we see is, and before we started this interview, I told you about our initiative in Eindhoven, but you also know I work for Logistic Community Brabant. We always start, we call it triple helix, companies, government, and education. So those are the actors, but we always start with more companies in kind of consortium. And one of the first thing, and we have a community model conference for that to say, well, what are the connections we need to fill in? Do we have the same values? Do we have the same vision, the same ambition, etc.? But one of the first steps is not try to look at a shared solution, but try to look at a shared problem. And basically a nuance is, don't look at a problem to solve, look at a solution which we have now that can be improved. So EDI is an improvement of how we did it before, sending letters to each other with 4 weeks in between sending and receiving when you had to do it by ship. So EDI is really an improvement of the physical letter, for instance. But still, EDI is not the end game. There's an improvement of that. So start with the solution companies use now and try to come together and how can we improve that solution. And yeah, people say, well, we used to have to buy a letter and an envelope and a stamp, and we had to write it, we had to go to the mailbox. So that a lot of different steps between me and the receiver, and we understand that email improved that. And that's the same how we work in our consortia, is we try to, we have to imagine the ideal situation within 10, 20 years, but we always look at how we did it historically. It's not new what we do now. And that is how we start. So we really start with awareness. How much waste do you have? And then you say, well, we have all the same problem. We all use the same solutions which we can improve. And from that basic level, we go to another stage. And one of the things what's important is don't rush, don't hurry. So blockchain will not change your way of living tomorrow, next year, maybe not next 5 years, but within this generation, it will change a lot. And if you step in 10 years from now, it's too late. It's basically not a business model we are looking for now, but a learning model. You have to learn, you have to adapt, you have to change your DNA, and that takes more time than just introducing a project and say, well, was the project successful or not? So basically, you know, the reports, Deloitte did that, they say, well, 90% of the blockchain projects failed. And people ask me, what do you think about it? I say, well, it would surprise me if they succeeded. Why? Well, say it's used for something totally different that blockchain was supposed to do. So you really have to look at the awareness, other ways of organizing, let go some autonomy. So you have to work together on supply chain. A lot of companies find that difficult. Before you start with the technology, you have to take some hurdles, and that's how where we start. So one thing, what we, for instance, have in our certified program is it's a community building simulation. So you put 12 companies together, they have all totally different interests, and at the end of the day, they have to underwrite one project and one ambition and one vision. That's what they learn. And it's possible, it's doable.
Excellent, and I'm sure the viewers would also love to understand a bit more about the certification process that you have. So, you know, maybe I'll get the details and put it in the video link itself.
Yeah.
You've been very successful in running blockchain projects, and especially getting different people involved in the process. What are some of the initial pushback? You know, I'm sure the viewers would like to know, you know, because they want to create a relevance. What are some of the pushback? What are some of the hurdles that you face?
Well, mostly a lack of time of money in the beginning. Also a lack of understanding, or try to understand. So That's why we put a lot of effort in awareness, in simulation at the beginning, in learning, etc. Not start too quickly, because I'm convinced, and that's also my technical background, I am convinced that technology will find her way. That's not the problem. Scalability, etc. is not the problem. We as human, we are the problem. So you could take the metaphor of a car. You have a gas and you have a brake. So technology is the gas pedal, and the brake is human and organizations that are really. So at this moment, we try to convince more and more companies to start with, we call it a digital transformation program. And you could say, well, we do that with backcasting. You know, you have forecasting, use historical data, and extra linear thinking. What will the future look like? No, that's not what we're doing. Imagine the ideal situation. An ideal is that we don't have to spend our precious time in offices. People don't like that. They have other things to do. So the ideal situation is when we go to the decentralized autonomous organizations where we don't need a human interaction anymore. And that's what we call Z. That's the end, Z. And backcasting will say, well, go from Z to today, it's A. And the first step is, how are we going from A to B, then from B to C? I don't know if you're familiar, probably you are familiar with Toyota Kata. It's the same kind of methodology. So from East to Zol, that you can, from A to B, you can define smart, specific, measurable, etc. But every step you do is in the direction of Z. And sometimes you have to take 2-3 steps back, but all is headed into the ideal situation. And a lot of companies have problems with that because it's, you know, the Kodak problem. Don't invest in something that makes yourself obsolete. And now the best digital strategy is the strategy that makes your old analog company obsolete. Because if you don't do it, somebody else will do it. And that's why we always choose for greenfield organizing. So start again, new fundamentals, a new building. And what you could do is in 1 or 2 years, you can transfer existing processes, profiling, selecting, purchase and payment process, you can put in your new building. And we did it already with shared service centers. We put process from department. And now you could say we are going to the next step is you could call it super shared service centers. So not on the level of companies, but on the level of supply chains. You have one ERP system. You have one reality. That's just the next step. And that's how we try to, you could say, sell it to companies. Well, it's naturally, logically, the next step you are setting now. And the best thing to do is to follow that program and not to go back to your own safety and try to resist as much as possible.
You took the example of Toyota. Any other methodology, I come from a lean management, Lean Six Sigma background. Any other methodologies that you end up using to make the adoption of the solution faster or more efficient?
Well, yeah, if you look at lean and mean, and that goes back to waste. So the waste is really the death of any achievement. Waste is always central in our approach. So the awareness around waste, etc. But if you look at the methodology in how to put steps forward, you could say, we also use them in our certified program. If you look at, for instance, it's not a methodology, but it's kind of tooling. It's Elements Cloud. I don't know if you work with it, but it's a SaaS tooling, and Salesforce also works with that. That you have in the supply chain together, you say, what are the steps from beginning to the end? So that's the supply chain. It's not one company, but it's the total chain. And every step you want to add in that supply chain, you have to convince the other people the why. Why is this step necessary? And if you say, well, I earn money on that, well, that's not a reason for the end customer. So if you look at Toyota, they started Toyota, they started in 1890 in, I don't know the English word, but it was already 100 years ago focused on lowering waste. So waste in the supply chain. So the 28 institutions between China and Rotterdam, they don't add value for the end customer. It's not necessary. So basically, yeah, we look, and also in my new book, you know, I'm writing a book about the digital supply, the digital assembly line. I really look at the historical development of the physical supply, physical assembly line, and started in 1913. But I think Toyota did the most in the way we organize fabrics at this moment, factories at this moment. So yeah, a lot of stuff we use from the if you look, for instance, the Toyota partnering model, they look totally different in the way they engage with their suppliers than Ford did, for instance. So yeah, but not always Toyota. We have a lot of methods, also models you can use. One of the models is the peeling model. So you start with the reality and go back to, at the lowest level, a use case, we say. It's an A and a B. So server A is asking question server B, and that's the lowest level. And from that lowest level, for everybody the same, you go back to the reality. So yeah, we use a lot of different methodologies, and some of them, yeah, are from the industrial era, because the principles are good. Of course, the context changed now from physical to digital, but the principles, they are good.
How important is trainings and workshops in a solution like this? If you compare it to the ERP days, the ERPs would give training, but that used to be at a lot later stage of how to use the system. But in this case, using blockchain, one has to give trainings and workshops right up front, because people need to understand the power of these technologies, but also in your case, the organizing side of things. How important is trainings and workshops for people?
It's the utmost important thing. And basically before training, because then probably you think about people from companies that come to the training, before that is education, so universities, etc. So if we still, you could say, produce students with all thinking, we have to train a lot, we have to change a lot. So basically, that was also this morning, I said to the people from the education institute, say, well, the questions you are asking are questions you could ask also 30, 40, 100 years ago. But the context changed. You could also look at the questions you're asking. And also the curriculum, it's educated at universities at the moment. It's the same as when I was educated 40 years ago. So basically, we put a lot of effort, and you know it from the Economic Foundation, we put a lot of effort in the subsidized education, so university and higher education in the Netherlands, because we really have to change the curricula. We have to change the way of thinking from teachers at this moment, because they always take default, the company is the best way to organize work. And that's not the case anymore. It's not the case. It's not true. So how do you change that bad idea? And you know, bad ideas also, they live long because people are used to that bad idea. So we shape the companies or the systems, and then the system will shape us. So basically, it starts with being aware and education at the university level already. And after that, yeah, of course, if you look at our programs, we always start with awareness, thought expeditions. Philosophy is very important. Simulations is important. So people have to become aware that there will be something after the offices, because we start with agriculture, and now only 3% or 4% in the Netherlands are working in agriculture, because they became a lot. They became productive, and then they went to the factories, and only 20%, 21% working in factories now, and most of them are working in offices. And if we can't imagine what's going to be after offices, technology, you can call it EDI, internet, cloud, it doesn't matter, blockchain, won't change anything. So basically, the more important question is not do we have technology to improve our businesses and processes, no. What do we do with the surplus that technology creates? And that what are we going to do if you're not needed anymore in the offices? Because if you don't do that, it won't change anything. And for me personally, I've been through that process with internet. I thought, well, internet, that will change everything. Focus too much on the technology. It's much more than technology. So you could say technology is a seed you plant, but if you don't have fertilized the ground, it doesn't do anything. So you have to create the circumstances in which your technology, your idea, your startup will flourish. So the circumstances are much more important. Like Philips, when they went to China in the 50s, they had the same problem. They had nice products, razors or TVs, but they have to create the circumstances in China. And that's much, much more important. So yeah, that's training, that's consultancy, that's digital waste assessments, privacy impact assessments, etc.
Blockchain and organizing. I'm sure it's more suitable for certain industries and functions and not so suitable for some other industry and functions. Any comment on that?
Well, it's most suitable in transactions and administration processes at this moment. But if you look further and you look, for instance, in smart industry, you know, at Tesla, they have a digital twin in the factory. So, you can also look in the physical products. So really, we have to use the abstraction, what data is, the representation. We have to use it much more better. And if we use it much more better, you could look at that industry, but also in smart cities, for instance. You could look at the occupation degrees of trucks on the road. So basically, internet didn't change the occupation degrees of trucks on the road. And now we have the problem of carbon. We have to reduce it. And the best way to reduce it is to look at data in how could we use data to bring supply and demand together. So if you're driving with your car to Eindhoven from Amsterdam and you are at the gas station and on your display is, well, we have a box here and you have to deliver it in the street where Paul lives, you have to go there. Can you take it with you? And via smart contract, you already realize the contract between the two. Then you really use data to lower carbon, to lower the occupation of streets or other facilities. And that's where we're heading to is, and if you organize it the way we do it now, you have America to say, well, let's private do it, Facebook, Google. In China and Russia, they look at public sector. In Europe, I think we have an advantage that we do it private publicly. So basically, if we in Europe accomplish that we could create, we call it a data commonality, data utility. So data should be organized in the same way as power or water. So in Holland, we have since 1957, we have a law that secures that you have clean drinking water. Why not create a law that you are sure that the data you get from me, that it's clean, that it's correct, that's a shared reality. So probably I hope to take part of it is that we say, well, politics can also arrange things in which we can organize a data commonality. That's very important because that's the infrastructure of blockchain. A lot of people look at the application, the wallet. You know the case of the horses that get replaced by the cars. The first cars were laughed at. Why? The technology was good, but the infrastructure wasn't adapted. So first we have also to work on the blockchain infrastructure. So after awareness training, we say, well, also look at the infrastructure before you start with an application too soon. Applications are important for trial and error, but applications have to connect to your infrastructure. Because I think you would find it rare that, or maybe stupid that at home that you have for every electric device that you have an hour power connector. You have one power system and you have different devices and one device that's transferring power to heat or movement, but we have one power grid. So basically we're working on, you could say, a blockchain infrastructure. From our Weeconomics Foundation.
And you mentioned about Elements Cloud. You know, I think we had spoken to Walter about this, as well as digital twins. I'm sure both these topics would be very interesting to viewers and we'll probably schedule another time on those topics. Looking at the future, what do you think, Paul? You're one of the experts. What do you think the future is going to look like in 5 to 10 years?
Well, we hope, and of course, if you look now at Corona, for instance, people get aware of that the Corona app is not possible at this moment because we didn't have adapted. There is no data infrastructure at the moment. So if you look at all kind of researches worldwide are done now in what's the best the best exit strategy, for instance, we don't know because everybody's doing it in a way that's not shared. Or so basically what you see now is that there will become more power on organizing these things in a smarter way. So I hope that this will help us to make a more quantum leap in how you organize supply and demand of data, because that's basically a blockchain is just a way of doing that, but basically is about data economics and data logistics. So we hope in 5 to 10 years that we have a lot of companies for some processes, low-hanging fruit process, you could say, If you start with blockchain, don't start at the customer side, but on the supplier side. Start with courses, for instance. Every company buys some courses or hardware. You can organize those processes on the blockchain. So we hope in 5 to 10 years that some of the not so essential processes of companies are organized in what we call the shared information and transaction network. And that's a good beginning. And after that, you could look at how to accelerate that. So how could you make a next step to that? So basically, we are working now on awareness, feasibility, simulation. And within 1 or 2 years, maybe 2 years, we also expect a standard of the ISO, the International Standard Organization. So once we have a standard on the blockchain protocol, you will see a lot of more applications built on that. So that's also happening in a couple of 2 years. So I think in 5 to 10 years, more and more processes are organized on the blockchain. Yeah.
And that brings us to the last question. Before we go, any practical tips that you would like to share with our viewers?
Practical tips is start small, smart. Try to engage with other companies, because most of the companies, they don't have an own innovation lab or department. But the most chances are not in the bigger corporation, because they have to lose the most. But if you are a small, medium enterprise, it's try to find each other and form a consortium. Six parties is already enough. Three suppliers, three customers, they can work together. And try to engage with a learning working program, what we offer, but more. You work also with Windesheim. I think they're also trying to start these kinds of labs, field labs. So try to engage with research and education institutes, where you can work together on these long-term improvement. It's nothing for the next year. So it's not a business model. Don't look at it as a business model. Look at it as a learning and value model. Because it's going to happen, you can't change the technology. It's there. It's not going to go away. So best thing is try to understand, how can this technology help me to thrive in the future?
So Paul, that was, I think, a great session. You shared a lot of insights and information. I'm sure the viewers are going to find valuable. Now, before we leave, a couple of questions. You know, one is, what's the best way people can reach out? Is it LinkedIn? Is it email? Is it Instagram? What's your favorite channel?
LinkedIn, I think. They just or they can Google me, come to my own website, paulbessems.com. Mm-hmm. And they can interact via the Weeconomics Foundation. That's weeconomics.org. But basically, LinkedIn is the first step. So just connect, and then you also receive information if you want it, but you can also opt out, of course. So the best way is via LinkedIn.
Excellent. And the other thing we want to mention to our viewers is that Weeconomics, as you may have heard, Paul, they organize a certification training course. And this is run by the foundation. And Paul has been great to announce that any student, any participant, any business person, professional who goes through this website, they are happy to give a 10% discount. I'm going to include a code in the description box so that you can avail of this. This is for a limited period of time, but it's a great course with a lot of details being shared by actually industry experts. And that's the best thing. It's not academicians, but industry experts who include this. So with that, I would like to bring an end to this program. So thank you, Paul, for taking our time and sharing your insights.
Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. And with that, we would like to end this program. So again, look at the description box for more details. We're going to share the various links that Paul spoke about, but also we're going to share the discount code. And the last thing is, we're living through a difficult time of crisis. Most of us are working from home. So I would hope that you stay healthy and stay safe in whatever part of the world you're in. And please don't forget to subscribe to our news channel on YouTube. Until then, goodbye.